Did the technical director for the WHO for the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic actually say rare asymptomatic transmission? Yes, she did. Did she mean to? Well, I don't know. I do think she meant to say it a little bit differently. Do I think she's totally crazy? No, I think she was actually right, believe it or not. But you got to get a little bit deeper into the details and unpack this to understand what I'm talking about. So let's go in and talk about who, what, when, maybe not so much where, but why. First of all, who was it? Dr. Maria Van Kerkhove. She's the WHO technical lead on the SARS coronavirus pandemic. When? June 8th, 2020, at a virtual press conference. What did she say? From the data we have, it still seems to be rare that an asymptomatic person actually transmits onward to a secondary individual. That's a quote. That's what she said. And then what happened? Well, a lot of people reacted, including one public health leader that a whole lot of people love to hate, Tony Fauci, said the comment on asymptomatic spread is wrong. Here's the difference between asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic, and that's where we start to get into the issue. Dr. Van Kerkhove actually said multiple times in multiple different ways, these people had minimal symptoms or they were developing symptoms. So this boils down to a major misunderstanding over asymptomatic versus pre-symptomatic. And who cares? Again, give us some time. Let's unpack it. We'll talk about it. We all should care. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. So then what happened? After that big press blow up, within a day, the WHO responded, and Dr. Tedros, everybody just calls him Dr. Tedros, he walked it back. He's the director general. Didn't really explain, didn't clarify. He just said, this virus has humbled all of us. Regarding the asymptomatic transmission item, he said he didn't backtrack from what she said. He didn't support or clarify what she said. He just said, that needs further research. Why did this happen? And what's this whole issue about asymptomatic versus pre-symptomatic? Well, just 5 days earlier, there were a couple of docs. One of them was Eric Topol. Eric Topol is a very, very well-known cardiologist. He's been at several places, including, I think, the Scripps Institute in La Jolla, obviously Stanford. Been in the Midwest. He's one of these people with a couple of hundred citations in peer-reviewed magazines. Very influential. And basically, here's what they said. They were creating this and documenting this growing perception that asymptomatic transmission accounts for half of the infections. Here's a quote from their article, Annals of Internal Medicine. Asymptomatic persons seem to account for approximately 40 to 45% of SARS-CoV-2 infections, and they can transmit the virus to others for an extended period of time, perhaps longer than 14 days. So you see where this is going. This is going to that old Typhoid Mary story. And that's the concern. What they're saying is that, maybe it's these 25-year-olds that are healthy, have no symptoms, have no clue that they've got infection, that are spreading this all over the world. Now, that's why this is becoming an issue. Here's more quotes from their article. Because of the high risk for silent spread by asymptomatic persons, it's imperative that testing programs include those without symptoms. Then they actually go on to recommend wearables, development of a wearable where all of us send in a daily result from our wearable on whether or not we have developed infection. Now, where are they getting all of this? Well, here's where they're getting all this. In fact, the vast majority of the article was a quote and rehash of about 12, 13 different examples of this quote asymptomatic. And again, I'll explain the asymptomatic again, just in case you didn't get it the first time. These are all quotes of the percentage of people that were quote asymptomatic at the time of the testing. in Iceland, 43%. Vaux, Italy, 41 to 45%. Diamond Princess, 47%. And then they went on to clarify actual proportions were 46 to 86%, quote, asymptomatic, end quote. Boston homeless shelter, 88%. LA homeless shelter, 64%. New York City OB patients, 88%. And again, they did give some lip service to the fact that the vast majority of the people in these, quote, asymptomatic groups are actually pre-symptomatic, meaning they're going to be infectious for a few days, very infectious, but infectious for, we don't know yet, maybe one, maybe three, maybe 5 days prior to actually having symptoms. So here's a couple of other quotes. The early data that we have assembled on the prevalence of asymptomatic SARS-CoV-2 infections suggests this is a significant factor in the rapid progression of the COVID-19 pandemic. Medical practice and public health measures should be modified to address this challenge. Focus of these testing programs should broaden to include people who do not have symptoms. So at the end of the day, what this is all about is Eric Topol and his friends saying we need to develop wearables. And he's a big wearables guy anyway. For the most part, I'm an Eric Topol fan. As you know, I've got plenty of videos where I diagnosed my own atrial fib using a wearable. I think those things are far underutilized. But I don't think he's right about this issue, at least yet. And obviously, Dr. Van Kerkhove doesn't either. She said, look at South Korea, look at Singapore. They did very effective contact tracing. And when you go back and you look at these successful programs, they did not find evidence that there were significant amounts of outbreak attributed to people that never developed symptoms. Therefore, contact tracing is a very viable way of dealing with this outbreak. So at the end of the day, what's the WHO position at this point? Not yet known, needs further research. Thank you very much for your interest. Why wait for a disease and hope for a cure? I used to be an ER doc. My name is Ford Brewer. I quit ER after a few years because it was just so frustrating. Most of the things bringing people into the ER are things that should have been prevented, including heart attack, stroke, number one cause of death, number one cause of permanent disability. People think that you're just going to have those and that they're not predictable. Both of those are wrong. They are predictable, and you don't have to have them. Usually it's lifestyle. Lifestyle is more important than supplements and even prescription drugs and even stents and surgery. But the current times are tough. Major financial impact with the lockdowns that most states have been going through. We've been working on a way to make this much more affordable with a subscription process. And that's exactly what we're announcing today. We've got two levels. One is the Silver membership, where you get access to our courses, a private webinar each month, and access to our supplement store and supplement recommendations and prescription. Or I would suggest even more so, the Gold membership. You can get a script for a freestyle Libre and find out what your blood sugar metabolism's doing on a daily basis. And you can get a lab order for inflammation, OGTT, and insulin survey. You can also get a 30-minute one-on-one with me. So I'm looking forward to seeing you. Cost is no longer an excuse. So if you're interested, go to go.prevmedheartrisk.com/prevmed-subscription or call us at 859-721-1414, 859-721-1414, or email us at myhealth@prevmedheartrisk.com. Looking forward to seeing you. Thank you.